Hi, I'm Dr. Brad. We're continuing our series on Lyme disease. So let's take a look at the lab test. That's what this section is really going to be about, is just the problems, the diagnostic problems we have with all this. Let's look at that lab test. You got a few different kinds of lab tests. You got indirect tests. Those are the ELISA, the antibody tests. And ELISA technology, when I first heard about it, I was really excited, thinking, boy, this flagship, and that's the way it's promoted. But that's where the Western blot is, IFA assay, the T-cell. The proposed Western blot reporting criteria is grossly inadequate, as Nina Zuba said, for the Lyme Disease Liaison from Harvard. Talked about it in Martha's Vineyard Hospital. 69% of the infected children, they have false readings. An interesting thing, Tom Greer is one of the most notable researchers in the whole field of Lyme disease. He quotes a study where 516 labs were taken from people. Most of those people had triple blood draws. They took up blood draws, they labeled them very carefully, so labs wouldn't know what they were doing, but they tracked them very carefully. And they sent those lab samples to the best Lyme labs in the world. Sometimes one lab would get three samples, sometimes three labs would get one sample. Of the 516 blood samples they sent to the Lyme labs, no two results were ever the same. Whether that was two results from the same lab or two results from different labs. Out of 516 samples, no two results were the same. Tom Greer says it's an absolute outrage. These tests should be outlawed. That's how inaccurate they are. The labs, Igenics especially, they used to publicize the accuracy of their tests. They took those statistics off of their sites years ago. Everybody's using them, but you have to understand, their accuracy is atrocious. In 516 samples, no two results are the same. I said a little bit ago, the lab tests are 0 to 20% accurate. People want to say 20%. I said, no, 0 to 20% is what Igenics used to publish years back before they took the results off of their site. So then we got the direct detection test, the PCR, the WAP, antigen capture, tissue biopsy, and staining. If you think about those, think of how successful it would be to take a needle and poke it in to be able to capture what you're looking for. Where do you put it in the body? How do they know where it is? How deep? What tissue? And swim around the blood. It uses the bloodstream for a highway and it gets out of it as quick as it can because that's where it's the most vulnerable. So to find it in the blood is not a reality. After 6 to 8 weeks, you don't expect to find it there because it's gone and it's localized wherever it wants to. I asked in a Lyme forum, Tom Greer, one of the foremost researchers, has anybody ever done definitive studies on what species of Borrelia harbor in what tissue, or any specific studies, species-specific studies for different therapies of effectiveness? And the answer was an absolute bold blank no. No studies. Center of Disease Control, they're the ones who regulate all the care on testing for rickettsia. The greatest challenge to clinicians is the difficulty of the diagnostic dilemma posed with infections early in the course when antibiotic therapy is most effective. They don't give the statistics, but they're saying the same thing. Because once you get after the early stages, you don't really have a way to test it. Test that really no validity. Tom Greer, citing 36 studies on Lyme disease in a paper they wrote, why the person who were diagnosing and treating Lyme disease, he states in 82, when the cause of Lyme disease was known to be bacteria, early medical papers were reported that 2 weeks antibiotics should be adequate. He cites five papers. Dozens of medical papers since 82 documented antibiotic failures in the treatment of Lyme disease. I mean, that's, I think that's 31 studies he cites right there. And this is an amazing thing. In every antibiotic treatment study since 82 to follow Lyme patients post-treatment for at least 3 months. So it's really giving a qualifier there. You got to follow them for a while to see how well things are working. Follow them for 3 months if your reports of relapse is occurring. So did the therapy really didn't accomplish what they thought it was going to? Every study is full of failures, but they keep doing the same thing. So when we look at that, this is what people are up against in their care and with their caregivers. Their caregivers are lied to with literature. Their caregivers have their hands tied behind their back on how they can address things, and they're people are trying things over and over, doing the same thing when the studies show it doesn't work.